Carly, thank you very much, and delighted to be here. What I didn't tell you is my mother submitted that bio for me. She is delighted, can I tell you? So look, delighted to be here. And Bryn only invites me every 3 or 5 years because he thinks I'm slightly revolutionary and he can't cope with it all the time. But I want to talk to you today, I think, about McCarney put her finger on it. What's the challenge to us, and I say us, as the simulation community? What is our challenge? And our challenge is effect and impact, just as McCarney said. So I just want to show you the last time, I know this is Gareth Patrickson's hometown, the head of Laerdal UK. The last time I was in Southport was in 1986, when my brother had just bought a Capri. Now, most of you will never even know what a Capri is, okay? It had all the disadvantages of a sports car with all the disadvantages of a saloon car. But in those days, I don't know if you still can, you can drive your car along the beach in Southport. So this was us. absolutely stupid. That is the last time I was in Southport and delighted to be there. I'm slightly concerned there's no volume there. I might just check that in the tea. I just better declare a few conflicts. I've definitely acted as an unpaid consultant to LIMS and Laerdal. I am a trustee and research lead for the Prompt Maternity Foundation, an independent charity. I will admit to you all, I'm an obstetrician. We are the hairdressers of the medical profession. I accept that. But, you know, I think maternity is a very useful vehicle for what we're going to talk about today. I am an academic too. I'm not sure how many academics are in the audience. I hope a few. And I will also admit to you, I believe simulation works. However, belief is not sufficient. And I think one of the, I'm going to try and talk to you today about, okay, let's talk about the beauty of the world of simulation. Let's talk about the exciting things, the models, the sim centers, the everything that goes with it. But I also want us to have a think about research and evidence. And I'm going to try and persuade you that simulation, we should think, and McCarney kind of said it, we should think more broadly than practice. Simulation is bigger than practice. It's an educational device which we can use for lots of different things. And I'm going to use maternity care as a vehicle to demonstrate what I think some of the benefits of simulation can be and what some of the challenges are. And I think today I'm also going to try and share with you some of our work on, we've mobilized our work down to practice, and we're all very good at that, but we're terrible. I think as a medical community, we are terrible at mobilizing our work up to policy. And I think the trouble is we all think about politicians. We go, oh, politicians, they're all horrible. Okay, we cannot blame politicians for doing the wrong thing if we don't tell them what to do. And I think we need to embrace that opportunity and be really clear about influencing at the highest level. And if we can do that, then the funding follows. Now, I think the challenges to us as a community of simulators is, let's get into the detail of training. I'm going to show you today, not all training is either equal or effective. Some training does more harm than good. And I think enthusiasm and belief are not sufficient. We have to get past that and get into what is the evidence for simulation-based training. And I think, as I said, I think my own feeling is that simulation is very good for training, but simulation is also the laboratory bench for patient safety. And I think we've got to keep the belief, keep the energy, develop the evidence, and secure the funding. And only by going through that process will we do it. And, you know, this is the kind of stuff you see all the time in the world of simulation. Thank you for saving me. Honestly, Prince William did not save your life. Let's be careful. And I think let's stop smile analysis as the main way of assessing the effect of simulation. Look how happy Kate Middleton is. She must be really good at simulation now. And I think we also got to get away from this kind of fetish for the more expensive, the better. Now, I will accept, I once made a massive mistake by getting my wife a very cheap handbag at Christmas. I thought it was really good value, but apparently there's a difference between cost and value. And although cardiologists only choose drugs because they're reassuringly expensive, the rest of us have to do the data to understand that. And I think it's the country life paradox. Any of you flick through country life when you're in waiting rooms, and people look at it, then they go, oh, I don't like that. Oh, I don't like that. Well, that's good, because you haven't got $5 million to spend on a house anyway. You know, and so we've got to get past this. We've got to get past this. And we've got to get into detail and evidence. And I think we've got to stop just thinking it must work. Because some simulation doesn't work. So let me just try this video. This is my favorite. I don't think, probably not many obstetricians in the audience, or some midwives maybe. How to teach operative vaginal birth. Okay. Can you just click on the video? Try that. Yeah, just click on it. Perfect. Okay, that is irritating. Another reason. Okay, we won't do that one. I'm hoping more videos work than this. Okay, so let me talk about simulation maternity care. I'm going to talk about evidence of effect, and there is a lot. I'm going to talk about what works there, and I'm going to try and persuade you there's something about right fidelity. There's not high and low. There's the right fidelity for that situation, and those are different things. I'm going to show you there are definitely cost savings to be made and how we can use simulation as a laboratory bench. Now, Prompt, Makani very kindly talked about Prompt, and I'll go into some detail about that in a minute. But one of the things I think, Prompt is not so much knowledge transfer as it is actually organizing a system. And when we talk about human factors, it's about organizing the whole system and the service, not just the people in that system and service. And I think one of the things we talk about all the time is local drills. You must standardize everything you can, but doing the local drills helps you stop it from becoming too brittle. It helps keep the flexibility in the system. And I think, just to give you an idea about high reliability organizations, this one they always choose is aircraft carrier. And they say, well, just imagine a busy airport, shrink it down to one short runway, one gate, make the planes take off and land at the same time, half the present time interval, rock the runway from side to side, put salt water and oil on it, and man it only with 20-year-olds. And I say to you, let me show you maternity. Move A&E into surgical theatres. Quadruple the number of emergencies. Increase the litigation tenfold. Take away all appointments and bookings. You imagine the orthopaedic surgeons. Okay? Open it 24 hours all year and do all operations awake with the relatives present. Now, I don't know if anyone has worked on any hip replacements recently, but lavender isn't a big thing for them, I don't think. Not every time I'm in. And man it only with juniors at night. And just to give you a feel, this is maternity care. Phew.
I've got a lady out in the car park giving birth.
So this is our unit on one born every minute 2 years ago.
Let the fun begin.
Of every day. A baby is born in Britain.
All I do, run.
It's an experience like no other.
I don't want to do it.
All right, well, we'll just cancel it, shall we?
It's your idea. My idea was a dog.
Yeah. You share with women such an amazing journey. You take them from being a woman to being a mother, and I think that's the biggest leap any lady can take.
Oh, look at her, she's beautiful.
Welcome to Bristol. Busiest maternity unit in the West Country.
She's beautiful.
Where new lives begin.
Yeah.
And others change forever.
think I'm going through that again.
Well, wasn't actually you.
This week...
Oh, girls, on a date?
Okay.
I still don't know where babies come from. It's terrible.
Okay, he is an anaesthetist, just want to say that. Now, it was incredibly popular. It was incredibly popular, patients. Now, anyone notice me on it? Anyone notice me on it? No, you're right. I wasn't on it. I didn't get. Now, they only chose our most beautiful staff. And you'll be surprised to know I didn't make the cut. And this is absolutely true. The producer came to see me and she said, oh, Professor Draycott, apparently you'll be on TV. So I went, oh, yeah, I should think so. And then she took a step back and she looked at me and she went, I think your waist is for radio. So I am officially too fat to be on daytime TV. What was amazing about it, they filmed 55,000 hours of TV to make 21-hour programs. So next time you watch reality TV, it's unreality TV. Look, okay, so let's talk about safety in labor and birth. Okay, if you ask mothers what they think, pretty much all mothers say, I want my baby to be okay. They say that first, and they often subjugate themselves to second. And partners, they don't really care about in labor, let's be clear about that. Now, that's what families want, it's what staff want, it's what the service wants. So how come there are a number of births in this country which are less safe than they could and should be? Now, that lack of safety has an enormous cost. So we currently spend nearly $1 billion in a year just for maternity claims just in England. However, we put $8.6 billion away last year to cover the claims we know are coming down the road. Okay, today the average cost of medical negligence, we pay four times the amount to lawyers and for damages as we do to midwives and doctors. That is absolutely unsustainable. We spend $85 million a week just on maternity litigation, and that's the same as funding a whole medium-sized hospital for a year. And let's not forget the second victim issues, and let's also not forget the time it takes to look at all these cases. It takes 150 hours a week per case to actually investigate and just do the detail of it. And the trouble is, everyone recommends training. And since 1997, there's been at least one report annually, probably two, that recommend training. But no one actually knows what training means. Training is such an aspirational, beautiful thing. But actually, show me the money. Show me what I can do tomorrow that's going to improve outcomes. And I always think about training in the old days. You know, this is just so you can laugh at me, but okay, this is 1999, I think. I was working in Cape Town, and I was desperate to have a go of a bungee jump. And this is just outside Cape Town. Looking good. Looking brave.
It's a courage, and you ready?
Yeah, they're ready.
Ready, counting.
Brave as a lion. Okay, the hard facts are, disappointingly, the hard facts are, I don't remember anything about it till I was coming back up. And I was desperate to have another go. I was absolutely desperate to have another go. And you get picked up in a little boat, you walk up to the top of this bridge, there's a kind of disused railway bridge, and my wife was there, she's pregnant with our third child, and I said, I've just got to have another go. And then I'll understand it, I'll know it, and everything else. She said, I don't know what's wrong with men, you're so stupid, you've got responsibilities now, you know, like, it's a disused railway bridge, why do you think it's disused, you know? And I never got another go. But it reminds me a bit of emergencies, that you get through the emergencies, and sometimes you're not quite sure which bit worked. And you just think, I wouldn't mind having another quick go of that again. that, I think, is one of the roles of simulation, that we can have another quick go of that again. And I think, yeah, we talk about, you know, there's a kind of fetish with aviation that I really don't like. I'm going to push back against that. You know, someone in my own specialty, Louis Rodosian in Manchester, has said that we should employ the principles of flawless execution. Sounds beautiful. It comes from a book about American fighter pilots. Honestly, that's not what birth is like, I don't think. Now, they're all beautiful people. Look, beautiful shiny teeth. They look great. I'll show you our team. They look quite not so great, maybe. Okay, £10 to anyone who can tell me which one's the anaesthetist. The one with a coffee cup. You're right. Yeah. Who thinks it's appropriate to have your photo taken with a coffee cup? Anaesthetist. And is flight like a labor? Well, I always think birth's quite accessible. You know, some of us have had babies, some of us had children, and we've all been born. Let's be clear about that. All right? So, but I think, you know, if you think about next time you're on a flight and someone said, welcome to Labour Airlines. The duration of the flight tonight is completely unknown. You're going to be flown by a trainee pilot who can phone a qualified pilot at home anytime they want. The emergency exit is here. it's just rubbish. It's not the same. And I think there are superficial similarities. There are deep differences. And I think let's be mature enough to reflect on that. And I think Mary Dixon Woods makes this fantastic analogy. She said, if you really want to compare medicine and aviation, maybe it's the baggage system we should be comparing. Actually, you know, there's a huge variation in shape, size, conditions. I'm sure for all of you, there are many, many women I care for who would not be taking off if they were a plane. All right? Let's just say that. All right? And all of us are engineers for planes, not pilots. Okay? So, and if you take up all these bags, they're going to a myriad of different destinations, and 10% of bags get lost. It's not quite as pure and beautiful as they make out. And Charles Vincent, who I'm not sure if any of you know, is the most beautiful thinker about this kind of stuff. And he wrote a really excellent book called Safety in Healthcare. And it's you can download it for free. It's a fantastic book. And he makes the point, look, there are some bits of medicine that are just like aviation. So blood transfusion is just like aviation. You can't give the blood unless you match four different bits of information. However, he makes the point that maternity care is like the fire service. You can do as much fire prevention as you possibly can, but every now and then that can be 100% safe. So let's be mature enough to think about actually the world we live in, not the world we'd like to live in. And if you look at the national reports, they say, well, actually, let's look about teams. Let's look at maternity teams. We train together. They say the best, most functional teams train together. They share common rituals and practices. And as well as training together, we communicate well together. And in maternity, of course, the leadership of the emergency might change. It's the midwife first, then the senior midwife, then the consultant, then might go to the anaesthetist, might go to someone else. So we've got to be flexible about sharing leadership. And although teamwork training is routinely recommended, I'm going to say to you, there are many, many examples of teamwork training that's had no effect whatsoever on outcomes. If you look at the MedTeams OB study in the US, big study in the American military. Remember, the American military is the second biggest provider of maternity services in the US. CRM training, they say, actually, Eduardo Salas, who, if you know Eduardo Salas, was the absolute doyen of human factors, now says, well, let's have a think about it. In some situations, it might even have a negative impact on what we're doing. And think about how functional we are. Now, you probably all work in beautiful places where everyone's nice to each other every day. But, you know, you can say to our anaesthetists, they go, yeah, I'll tell you, there's two sorts of surgeons. but now I know it's been filmed, probably I better not read it out. There's only two types of surgeon, and slow, right? You know, you do any drill with anaesthetist, someone comes in and goes, no one doing the airway. You know, most obstetricians think an airway is something you use on holiday. And this timing, I mean, you know, so when I was doing gynae, which I gave up to do a bit more research, but the anaesthetist I'm doing my list, Colin Hall, he used to have this enormous white clock on a string as a protest to being told that he wasn't allowed to wear a watch anymore. And he looked like the White Rabbit in Alice in Wonderland, you know. And I said to him one day, Colin, I said, and he was, if you're going to do something well, do it really well, right? If you're going to be curmudgeonly, be really curmudgeonly, right? So then I said to him, I said, Colin, I said, is that clock to time how long my list overruns? Funny surgical joke. He goes, if it's your list, Mr. Draycott, it'd be a calendar. Fantastic. You know, the anaesthetic, you know, the neonatal ABC of resuscitation, arrive, blame, criticize. Someone told me D is for depart as well. You know, but actually it's a symbiosis. It's a symbiosis. We absolutely need to work together. And okay, we talked about it. And I've struggled to get one of Bryn's papers into my talk, but I have. Okay, showing very clearly no change in clinical outcomes after human factors training was introduced. Fact. Let's have a think about that. Let's have a think about teamwork in maternity care. So this is teamwork. It's my favourite thing. Okay, take injured player off the pitch. It's not that difficult. That is actually your job. You know, and if we're gonna deconstruct that and say how about communication, set the scene, all those things, it would work well for that too. But let's have a look at maternity teams and not just everyone else's teams. So we did a big piece of work called Safe Study, videoed 19 teams of six, and we videoed them doing drills in a labor ward room in their unit, in six different units, eight different units in the Southwest. And interestingly, there was no correlation between team performance. What we did was look at eclampsia, and we looked at those teams who gave magnesium sulfate the quickest versus those who gave magnesium sulfate the slowest. And we looked at the top quartile and the bottom quartile. There was no difference in MCQ scores. And we analyzed it every way. Total, highest, midwife, obstetrician, everything. No difference. No difference in individual skills and no difference in safety attitudes. The characteristics of the most effective teams, someone said this is eclampsia earlier in the most effective teams. Now, all of you are thinking, well, that's what I teach. State the emergency. Now, but trouble is sometimes, what that is permission giving to state the emergency, because sometimes you're very reticent, particularly in maternity care when everyone's awake. You can't run in and go, oh, this is eclampsia. This is the most life-threatening condition in maternity care today. We just say, this is eclampsia. The proportion of directed commands was higher in the most functional teams. And interestingly, that reduced the overall level of communication. And fewer people left the room because we said, okay, Bryn, can you put a line in? Akani, can you give some syntocin on? La, la, la. Okay, you all know about that. But let me just show you that when people have tried to implement this kind of stuff at scale, it doesn't seem to be as effective as we'd like it to be. So the TOASTI study in Netherlands cost 10 million euros. Randomized 12 maternity teams to training and 12 maternity teams to no training. They did their training in the SIM center. They did 80% teamwork training, 20% clinical. Made no difference to any, no positive difference to any clinical outcomes. And some outcomes got worse in the trained teams. 10 million euros. Sign up to safety, 8.6 million pounds in the UK. Okay, made no difference at all to any outcomes. A really beautiful, beautiful piece of work from Sweden where they trained all 46 obstetric units. They looked at peer review process, they looked at simulation-based training, they did a whole series of interventions, again, made no difference at all to any outcomes. In Denmark, they trained 97% of working obstetricians and midwives. How to look at a CTG made no difference at all to any outcomes. Look at shoulder dystocia. So you'll know shoulder dystocia, the head's born and the baby's shoulders get trapped behind the mother's symphysis pubis most commonly. Okay, two centers, Oxford and Bristol, both started training for shoulder dystocia at the same time, both published in the same journal without knowing each other. Okay. We reported a 70% reduction in brachial plexus injury. Oxford doubled their brachial plexus injury rate. So they doubled the rate of injury after training. Let's be serious about looking what works. And if you look at the literature now for shoulder dystocia training, so one study increased the injuries, four studies no change at all, five studies improvements. So what was the difference between the five that improved and the five that didn't? Well, one of the biggest issues is the models we use. So I went to do some training for shoulder dystocia. They said, don't bring your model, Professor Draco. We've got a great one. Well, that baby's had its nose rubbed off. And I don't know about its shoulders, but they didn't look too good to me. Now, you go to the States, and the States, they quite like the kind of big fluff up, don't they? And they said, oh, you're coming to Johns Hopkins. They said, I'm really pleased you're coming. You're going to see the most biophilic model in the world. I thought, wow, that's amazing. Because I thought biophilic meant lifelike. You know, there's not a conscious woman in the UK who would wear socks in labor, right? Secondly, anyone here seen Toy Story 2? I mean, you know, most mothers I know are not looking for a screw going through the ear or the top of the head, right? And I'm just going to show you, this is their model. Here we go. The most lifelike model in the world.
Way.
Oh yeah, and the other way. Oh yeah. Okay, now check out the neck.
Oh wow, that's what I'm doing.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Check it out.
Huh? That's just like the model they use here, like this regular.
Yeah.
Non-articulated model. Yeah. We have this one.
Yeah. I'm completely convinced. and okay, they were completely convinced. I'll say that to you now. And okay, so let me just show you. All right. There were three models used. I'm not going to go into the detail of them. And this is not, the effective one was not the most expensive one. Okay, one model increased, associated with increases. The same model was used in all four cases where there was no change. And the same model was used in all five cases where there was a positive change. So maybe the model we use should be fit for purpose. Not all models do everything. And there is an evidence base for models in the same way as there is for training and interventions. And in fact, now this data is so powerful now that you can see that the RCOG now makes recommendations in the shoulder dystocia guideline on how we should train for shoulder dystocia. In Bristol, you saw all the things that don't work very well. In Bristol, we had a 50% reduction in low apgars and HIE, and we've just submitted a paper showing a 45% reduction in children going to school with cerebral palsy. Okay, that's a benefit. It's a benefit to those children. It's a benefit to society. It's a benefit to everyone. We've reported a series of over 32,000 consecutive vaginal births with zero permanent brachial plexus injuries. You can show that you can reduce the decision delivery interval, and if you get those things right, then in fact the litigation costs look after themselves. Now, that's all good, and you might say, well, maybe that's just Bristol, And also, one of the things I think we do in simulation not very well is we don't operationalize simulation for other people to use. We expect everyone to reinvent the wheel in every single place. So one of the things we did with Prompt, we published all this work, and people said, well, can we do that? So we have a what we call a course in a box. It's a course manual, a trainer's manual with 22 drill recipes. Let me just say that. They're all the ones that are nationally recommended. We have a whole series of downloadable tools. If you want to see them, then I can show them to you. I think there's 250 downloadable tools. All the talks are downloadable. All the drills are downloadable. All the algorithms are downloadable. Everything is there for you to use. Let's operationalize effective training. And we also provide telephone email support for a year. So this is a very standard eclampsia drill. Can you see, is, you know, all the equipment is identified, what the scenario is, and what the aims are. What should we be doing? And you can pick and choose. Like any recipe, you can say, I'm going to have that today, you're going to have that today. And I think it stops you. I think sometimes it's a bit boring doing simulation. It's like feeding the kids. You think, oh, I had spaghetti bolognese last night. What am I going to do tonight? You know, this is about serving suggestions. This is about things you can take off the shelf and do yourself. We do feedback after drill. I'm not a big fan of video feedback. I'll say that now. And we certainly can't do it in our local setting. But I think we've got to put the structure into feedback so people can feedback to themselves. I can talk about that a bit more later on. And you might say, well, does it just work in Bristol? Well, we got some money from THET, one of the UK government funders, and we demonstrate a 34% reduction in mothers dying in a hospital in Zimbabwe. Now, interestingly, the staff in Zimbabwe said the main difference was it reduced hierarchy. The training reduced people arguing and reduced doctors, in particular, dismissing midwives. So one of the women who died before we started training died because the SHO, who had only just started, did a cesarean, did not close the uterus, closed the sheath skin out. And the woman just gently exsanguinated. Now, every single other person in the room knew that was an issue. But no one, and we talked about speaking up today. You know, so training in your unit allows you to communicate better. The Philippines. This is funded by Ferring, a pharma company, and a charity called Project Hope. We just finished this, and the Philippines government have just published a 26% reduction in maternal mortality in seven big units, 43,000 births a year. We can definitely make a difference. We just need to demonstrate it. America. Does it work in America? Yeah. Exactly the same outcomes, improved you know that America and the UK is two countries separated by a common language. I think improvement in nurse satisfaction with physician interaction sounds a bit Doctor in the House to me. But I think what they mean is communication. But they got exactly the same improvements in low APGARs, exactly the same improvements in brachioplex injuries, exactly the same improvements in litigation savings. Victoria, Australia. Exactly the same improvements in outcomes. This is not official Prompt merchandise. We do Prompt because meconium happens. It's a joke only for midwives, clearly in the audience. that is not official Prompt merchandise. You can even teach general surgeons to be more like obstetricians. They don't really like it phrased in that way. But you can do exactly the same training. And we talked earlier on in one of Bryn's session about actually a hemorrhage training program is almost the same irrespective of the focus of the hemorrhage. Because the first 20 minutes is about fluid resuscitation and deal with the hemorrhage. So that's the same for bleed on the ward, GI bleed on the ward, as it is ENT, as it is in maternity, as it is in A&E. So maybe we should start generalizing some of these drills, you know, sepsis, collapse, hemorrhage, all of which are very, very multi specialty. This is Bob Patterson. So Bob Patterson recently reviewed all the 23 published reports of obstetric emergencies training and concluded very clearly the only ones that improved outcomes were local in the unit, and they had mandatory annual training. And I think there's something about local training which is really, really important. There's something about working together to deal with their own problems. There's no unit more like your unit than your unit. Do you see what I mean? And I think in our world, because everyone's awake, it's essential we work with patient actors as well as mannequins and all the other things we've got to use. And also, I'm gonna put it out there. So this is Margaret, she used to be a healthcare assistant with us. She retired at 70, I think she's 71 in that picture. And she used to come along for the training, and she was excellent. You didn't have to program her. You don't even have to plug her in, and she doesn't even need a cupboard to put her in at the end of the day because she walks home. And actually, she can feed back to us about how she felt during the drill. And that is a really, really essential work in our world. That's Sean Edwards on the other side just there. Kathy Winter, one of my co-leader for Prompt, and really the brains behind Prompt. She's the only person in the world to walk through Marks and Spencer, see a 44 double D bra, and think, "Hey, I can make an inverted uterus out of that." But actually, and we talked to, in our there's a neonatal group, we're talking, and pediatric group, we're talking today about, you know, early warning charts. Well, okay, we have to. You can't just bring these tools in. You have to socialize them and normalize them through the training. That's what training's for. So Mary Dixon Woods always, she came to see our group in action. And one of the healthcare assistants said, in the respiratory rate, you have to write a number. I thought you wrote just yes or no. Now, if it has been me feeding my, I would have gone, yes or no. Seems a bit binary, breathing, not breathing, you know. But Kathy Winter, as I said, the main research fellow, she said, "I love your question. I love that question. No, put the number in, then we can see it change over time, la, la, la." Okay, three other people asked the same question that day. And I think we have to make simulation and training a place of safety where you can ask questions that you can't ask in normal clinical practice. Let's also have simple tools to help us do the right thing. Let's have simple algorithms, and let's use those algorithms in the simulation. We should be teaching, we should be learning how to use your system, not just how to manage a PPH. We have simulation, these are PPH boxes, and we do our standard drills. You will use the simulation, the PPH box you have in your unit. And in fact, we're just doing some work at the moment. That's literally a cardboard box. We went to Sheffield, I was saying to McCarney earlier on, and this very, very trendy design engineer, sort of hipstery, sort of beard, tattoos, really thin, narrow trousers. And he said, you know, he looked at this PPH box and he went, "Did you design that yourselves?" Yeah. So he then helped us, and we're working with this group in Sheffield. Can we actually literally make, can we join up the algorithm with the supply chain? Can we put everything together in one place so we can use it? We have a YouTube channel. I recommend that to all of you. And we've decided actually maybe we're working with limbs and things to actually make them slightly more professional and slightly better to look at. And the shoulder dystocia one, we're in like 40,000 views in 4 or 5 months. You know, I mean, there's some sad, lonely people, but you know. But we've also been able to say, okay, let's look at prompt style teaching. Let's think about using critical care. So HDU is really big for us now in maternity, particularly because you get paid extra for it. So, but one thing is, obstetricians are terrible at critical care. Because we just say, is the baby born or not born? And actually, there's a lot more to it than that, and I think we have to train to have a think about how we should do it. We've got undergraduate prompt, where just my point earlier on, now this can be done, I think, usefully in sim centers and other centers, where we do shoulder dystocia because that's what we like, but we also do hemorrhage, sepsis, and collapse. Because it doesn't matter what sort of doctor you're going to be, you're definitely going to need that. Now, we then have third year midwifery students. And what's interesting is, when you ask people to do the drill, instead of just bossing around and say, just be nice to each other, in fact, they pick that up very quickly. Because after a while, they know they've got to give fluids for a hemorrhage. So they pick up the medical students who do virtually no clinical work. But the midwifery students do loads of clinical work. And so when they pick up a fluid, they pick up a fluid bag, they pick up the giving set, and they go. And one of the midwives will say, oh, that just goes in there. And you start to learn, actually, maybe you should work better together. And actually, we demonstrated, you know, in Stelios's journal Nick's Sevadelis's journal, that improves interpersonal attitudes. We also do pre-hospital prompt for ambulance staff. I don't know if there's any paramedics here, but what was amazing to us was we did a paramedic drill for normal birth, and we used the standard model, which stops at the knees. You've probably seen that model. And the paramedics rushed in, and we had a midwife sitting behind it, and the paramedics go, right, bilateral traumatic amputation. Okay, start sorting her out. Put two lines in, phone the hospital, whatever. I mean, and the midwife goes, no, stop. No. It's not that. It's just a normal birth. So they were more frightened of a normal birth than they were a bilateral traumatic amputation. That shows the world they live in. But let's help them do the right thing. And so I'm going to try and... I think simulation is more than knowledge transfer. And it's not just simulation. It's about learning to use tools together. It's about structuring systems and learning to use those systems. I think training in teams is team training. I don't think we have to fuss it up too much more. And I think we need to do simulation for research as well as simulation for training. And I think we have to have the right fidelity models. And I think one of the things the manufacturers are going to have to deal with is there's soon going to be an evidence base for models, like there is for drugs. And we should use that evidence base where it exists. So let me talk to you about the laboratory bench for safety. Shoulder dystocia we've done. Delivery of impacted head at cesarean section. I don't know if you know, this is a massive issue in our world. This has only just arisen in the last few years. We don't really understand why. I always think if you could describe it, imagine pushing a ball into a flower pot. How do you get your hand around the ball to get it out of the flower pot? Do you push up from the bottom or do you pull it up from the top? It's very technically very difficult. And any obstetric anaesthetist, they will definitely recognize the issues around this. Now, there are lots and lots of things you're meant to do, but no one has ever trained to do them. And just to give you an idea of the issues, okay, each one of those is a skull fracture under a fingertip. Okay, that is the sort of panic and problem we're seeing. And this is a really big issue in current maternity care. And I think one of the things we've got to do is actually use simulation to understand it. We would never be able to understand this in real life. There's no amount of videoing, no amount of anything that's going to help us do it in real life. And I think, can we use simulation to understand it? So again, this is a collaboration. This is some work we're doing with Sheffield. And when you work with proper engineers, okay, you can print a pressure sensor onto any surface now. So what we're doing is working with LIMS, working with Sheffield, and we're wrapping those pressure sensors around a head, and you can then measure, we can measure the amount of force that's used. You can see it there. And the second thing we're going to do is use augmented reality to try and understand how we're going to use this in its most effective way. So we can design tools to help us understand the problem to devise the solutions. This is Kathy Winter, one of our main research providers, as I said. she'd never seen augmented reality. She was deeply impressed. The 18-year-old programmer who's with her was less impressed. And he said to her, you can make it disappear by doing that. And Kathy said to him, does that work for husbands? And he said, no. So I think we've just got to get into tools to help us understand things better. And this is, in fact, that's Katie Cornthwaite on the left who's doing this research. And we're actually starting to work on a model both to investigate the problem and potentially then to teach about the problem afterwards. I know all of you are not too interested in the finer points of operative vaginal birth, but this is the Odon device, which some of you may have heard of. It's meant to replace forceps and vacuum by delivering a baby in a plastic bag. Now, it has been blessed by the Pope. This is the Vatican, in case any of you didn't know that. That is Jorge Odon, an Argentinian car mechanic who invented it. And it's my favorite thing. Have anyone been to the Vatican? It's my favorite thing. Absolutely brilliant. You put your invention in a gold frame. Okay, one thing the Vatican is not short of is stuff to put on the wall. They've seriously got some art. They seriously have. So anyway, the Pope has blessed it. But I looked up, systematic review of randomized trials, randomized trials, case cohort studies, couldn't find papal blessing anywhere. So I think we do need to do some real work. And in fact, that's how you deliver a baby in this new device. I know all of you are thinking, why would you put a plastic bag on a baby's head? Okay, remember, it's not breathing till the chest is born. Remember that? Okay. So now, but again, we did some funded work, and I think I encourage all of you to reach out to people to get this kind of work in your sim centers and research groups. So this is some funded work where they wanted to know how much force was applied to the baby's face using the Odon compared to forceps, everything else, and it's much, much less using the Odon. It's also very reliably cited, and we published a whole series of papers about this in simulation. The policy landscape. Now, all of you who are working in the real world, and you're working at the coalface, I think sometimes we don't look up and see the policy landscape except to think, golly, it's just mad. And this is what we think it should look like. I always think that there's mothers and babies at the beginning, there's kind of training, all the national bodies, the NHS, all the NHS structures, in this kind of beautiful, focused, lovely way that's focused and concentrating on women and their babies. But in real life, it's like that. And I think all of us are overwhelmed by recommendations, by missives to do better, to improve outcomes, with no real understanding of what it's like at the coalface. And I think we as professionals, in its broadest sense, we need to start thinking about how we link up national bodies, professional bodies, staff, women and their families across the system and the service. And I will try and say to you that only the insurers might be the key to this. And I think we've got to think about how to engage with both the NHS at its highest level and also insurers and all the other parts of the NHS. Now, I spent a very excellent 6 weeks in Melbourne as researcher in residence with the Victorian Managed Insurance Authority. And I can promise you now that Melbourne in January is better than Bristol in January, okay? But what was fascinating about it was getting a much broader system-level view and what the drivers are at the top level. And I think all insurers and the NHS and all funders, they want to know, What big levers can I pull at the top to get bottom-up improvement? We then did some research with the Health Foundation to get a whole load of insurers into one room. Now, one of the insurers, I think it's positive, said, "That was surprisingly excellent." I said, "Thanks." But what was clear was there was no forum for them to actually meet clinical teams. There's no way of contact. I don't know if any of you have had any kind of contact with any insurers in your patch, except when there's been a case. And I think insurers have, they've got all the system level contacts, and they can influence at all levels, the very top level, the very bottom level. And I think they work really well as system integrators. Because, okay, so let me tell you about a hospital in the US. And we have the same in the UK. So hospital in the US published where they introduced a maternity training program. They improved obstetric outcomes and thought to save about 200,000 US a year. But the neonatal unit lost 350,000 US a year, so they stopped the training, because the hospital was making a loss. Now, we have the same in the UK, in the maternity units bear the total cost of training, but the benefits of less injuries are everywhere else in the system. And I think insurers, only insurers, can link all of that up together. Now, if you look at our training, so training in the UK, we're about 7,000 births a year. Just to give you an idea, it costs us $140,000 a year to train all our staff one day a year. 92% of costs are staff costs. But if we are going to get improvements, we've got to stop pretending to government that training is free. It's not free. But it can be offset against other costs in the system. So let me show you, that's Bristol. So this is some very early work we did. That is the costs of training, our litigation costs before training and our litigation costs after training. If you look at Australia, these are the most recent data. These data are a month old from Australia. They rolled out prompt in 24 units in Victoria. And they've just demonstrated a 53% reduction in claims frequency after rolling out prompt. The average cost per claim and the average monthly litigation cost have also dropped by about half. And there's been a 49% reduction in average cost per maternity claim and a 57% decrease in overall monthly maternity costs. Now, the Vic Prompt, the initiative, started by the VMIA, they lobbied Victorian state governments to mandate Prompt. They pump prime the cost of training. If I gave you 50,000 to do training in your unit for your specialty, you're probably quite pleased with that. We do not do that currently in the UK, and we need to. They then said, okay, we're going to incentivize training by providing the training and giving you some money to do it. And then we're going to do premium modeling to give you a discount for best outcomes and less of a discount for not best outcomes. And they also have a very, very strong regional support network where everyone who does prompt training in Victoria meets up quarterly to discuss how they're doing it and how they're going to take it forward in a stronger way and sharing learning around the network. And so one of the things we did was try and think about, okay, can we express the value of simulation-based training in the same way as we do for drugs? So we've just submitted this paper to the British Journal. And what we did was we surveyed people with Erb's palsy, a brachial plexus injury. We looked at adults with a brachial plexus injury and parents of children with a brachial plexus injury. Now, remember I told you that we've not had any injuries at all for 30,000 births. Okay, the average rate in the UK is 3 per 10,000, so we should have had 9 roughly in that set. And what we did is EQ5D, we then made it a utility. So can you see, if you have a brachial plexus injury, it reduces the quality of your life by about 40%. And if you're a parent, it reduces the quality of your life by 20%. And in fact, you can then work out what the qualies are. Now, remember that NICE will fund any cancer drug that's better value than £25,000 a quality. If shoulder dystocia training was a pharmaceutical intervention, we would prescribe it for everyone. And I think we've got to start speaking the language of policymakers as well as get the evidence. And this is the most recent, and McCarney will definitely know this, and any of the midwives in the unit will know this in here. Okay, so now NHS resolution will discount your insurance if you do this simulation-based training. To us, that's worth about $500,000 a year. So $500,000 a year just in the maternity budget makes a massive difference. And I think we've got to start thinking about how we engage with policymakers to bring in this sort of initiative. I think we need more and better research. I think we need to mobilize evidence down to practice and up to policy. And I think we've got to engage and not sit in our little silos, think we're doing beautiful things and all politicians are horrid. There are many that are, I'm sure. But we have to engage with them and influence them to do the right thing. What are the next steps? I think we definitely need to work out what works where. And also start getting into patient safety and quality improvement. Simulation is an essential part of those two elements, and those are very heavily funded. I think we've got to work with policymakers to secure funding for us to do the right thing. And I think we've got, as I said right at the beginning, let's keep the belief, keep the energy, but develop the evidence and secure the funding. Thank you very much. I will just say, McCarney, that is the Queen's Anniversary Prize for Excellence, and it's awarded every 3 years. You go to Buck House, it's pretty good. I